Hey, hi everyone. So thanks for having me here. It's actually the first time I'm attending WordCamp, so it's great to be here. Just by a show of, I'm actually not a tech guy, but how many of you are developers here? That's a lot. And publishers? Okay, so I think the bulk of my slides are more for publisher base. I'm not a tech person, but I just want to share my journey of using WordPress and how it kind of like changed maybe my career or what I do and things like that. So I hope it's something useful and something that you can take away from it throughout the whole day of events. So just a little bit about myself. So I own a few things. So Alvinology Media LLP, which is a boutique social media and digital agency. So we run campaigns for different clients in Singapore, including like the likes of like Qatar Airways, International Intercontinental Hotel Group, IHG, ASUS, some of the other tech clients, GoBear.com, which is an insurance comparison site and so on, Golden Village Cinema. And we also represent a group of websites in Singapore, including Alvinology.com and a few other websites. And we have a network of influencers that we work with in Singapore as well. And I'm the editor and founder of Alvinology.com back in 2007. I have about 16 contributors at the moment, and they're based in different countries. Most of them are media professionals, but it started out as a one-man blog, so I'll share more about that later. And I'm also the co-founder for another site called Asia361.com, which was started back in 2015. It's a travel, luxury, and lifestyle site with about 50 contributors and a full-time managing editor who's my partner. And another website that I own is thepoppingpost.com, which is syndicated with Yahoo Movies and Singtel as well. It's a movie and cinema site that's focused on content around cinemas and movies, and it's a collaboration with Golden Village Cinema. And I have a day job as well. I work at a company called migme. I don't know if you guys heard of it. I have an ex-colleague here, Lester, who used to be from migme as well. So migme is an Australia-listed social entertainment platform. We have about 35 million monthly active users in Southeast Asia and South Asia. So I head the content team in the region. And one of the portfolio sites that we own is hipwi.com. So anybody from Indonesia here? Have you heard of hipwi? But HipWi has about 15 million page views each month. The team is based in Jogja, about 20 staff. Yeah, so that's one of the team that I work with for migme. And previously, I worked with many different publishers as well. Singapore Press Holding for quite some time, doing digital and social media marketing. News Corp, which is the parent company for Wall Street Journal, Dow Jones, and Financial Times, and so on. So I was one of their first hire when they set up their office in Southeast Asia to take care of their social media for the Southeast Asia and Japan market. Temasek Holding briefly to just do social media stuff. And I also work at the Nanjing 2014 Summer Youth Olympic Games in China, where I headed the content team for everything that's in English that's on their website. So that's what I do. So just now, all the things that I mentioned, right, there's a few sites that were mentioned there: alvinology.com, asia361.com, the popping post, discover.migme, which is the site that we push content on migme, hipwi.com. There's one thing in common for all the sites that I was working on, and it's not because I'm the one who made the decision. Some of the sites when I worked there, the decision was already the CMS was already in place, and all of them use WordPress. So yeah, it ties back to the intro site that Valentine shared earlier. Actually, WordPress power a lot of sites, and that's the reason why. Very soft, sorry. So this is a bit more about myself. So this is my main site. The page views range around 400,000 thereabout, Instagram about 70,000 and so on. So we syndicate our content to Yahoo and Newsloop on Singtel as well. And because of the exposure that I get from my blog, I get to work with a lot of brands. So these are just some of the brands I work with. There are some strange ones like Durex and Yeah, somebody actually wrote me before to ask me to review a artificial vagina before. It's like some sex toy. It's get all kind of funny requests. And then the more legit one, like Coca-Cola, I just shot a video with them to promote Coca-Cola and brands like Shell and Eva Air, Canon, so on. And yeah, so it's been a journey. So since I started my blog in 2007, I got to work with many brands and see different things, a lot of exposure. In fact, I was just in America last week together with Princess Cruises, where I visited Alaska and Victoria, Canada, and so on. And I got to see the Glacier Bay and all those, thanks to my blog. So how it all started? So initially, when I started blogging, I don't know if you guys remember this. I'm quite old, so I don't see many older people here, but I'm quite old. So when I started blogging, there wasn't such things as blog. There was something called GeoCities. So how many of you know GeoCities? So you set up that stupid page, and then you have to code everything yourself just to put, welcome to my page and a few pictures. And I did some stupid page about being a beach bum and all those with some friends. But that was GeoCity. And then there is the Singtel Moblog in Singapore. How many of you heard of that? So there's that Moblog thing that you can use SMS and all those to write, and the ringtones and all those. So that got me excited about blogging, that you write rubbish and people actually read it. And okay. And then there was Zanga. So Zanga was the first kind of blogging that I did. So what happened then, I was doing my internship. So internship is kind of luck, right? So I happen to be in it's a big company, I won't name it, but you can probably find it on my LinkedIn. No, I didn't put it on my LinkedIn. But anyway, I was in a big company in the APAC office, and apparently they don't have much work for me to do. So then I took up blogging just to kill time, and I started writing on Zanga. Initially, it was just to amuse myself and another intern who has nothing to do, and we just read each other's Zanga. And then I started building a very large following of like 10 people. And then it grew to about 50, and I felt very proud. And it's like, I felt so good about myself, and I'm writing all this rubbish. And yeah, but that was what it was. It didn't go any further until things got a little bit more serious when I started working. So I started work, when I entered the workforce, I was doing online marketing and digital media stuff. So I started blogging on alvinology.wordpress.com in 2007, and I did it as a social experiment to test different kind of content, because my job was to market content, right? So I find that if I have a blog, it's actually good for me to test out different, do A/B testings and things like that, to see what kind of content work, how do I get people interested in content, and then I can apply in a real world situation. Because I can't do experiment on SPH website, but I can do it on my blog. So that was what I did. And because of that, I got really good with it, and the rest follows. So one of the first articles I did, it was an instant hit. So what happened was that, if you see the picture there, this was the first article I published on the blog. And straight away, my blog didn't go from like one, like previously, 1 to 10 to 50 readers. Straight away, there was a few thousand readers. In fact, more than that, I think it's a couple, tens of thousands. So what happened was that I went to a book fair in Singapore. How many of you know Neil Strauss, the author of The Game? Any of you read the book? The Game, yeah. So is this book about, this Neil Strauss author, he's a best-selling, New York Times best-selling author. He teach you about tactics about how to get girls and so on. So he wrote this book about how to make money like a porn star together with a real porn star, Jenna, I think it's Jenna Jameson or something from the US. And it's the comic book there. So it was sold in the Singapore Book Fair in a kid's corner. I don't know why they put it there in the kids' corner, together with all the manga and the comics and all those. And there were some kids that were like enjoying to learn how to make money like a porn star, and they were reading it. Yeah. So I got some pictures, and I thought about it, like, what can I do with the pictures after I get it? I can probably send it to the press or file a complaint and things like that. It's not right, right? I mean, you saw something and you want to fix it. And I thought that why not I just do some testing and see how far I can make the story go. So what I did was that I wrote it on the blog post, and after that I seed it to the SPH Media. I think I seed it to Storm, I seed it to MediaCorp, which is a TV station and so on, and I got full coverage. At the end of it, everything links back to my blog, because that's the only source with the pictures and everything. So I got all the exposure I want, and I found that, hey, you can actually create viral content and so on if you kind of plan it out. So that's what I did, and that's the result. And it got me excited. Like, you can actually get it done. And I even got an email from Neil Strauss later on. So the thing blew quite big. The author actually emailed me and, you know, trying to explain to me and saying that it's actually a good comic, it has good values and so on. But it already got, I think it got a warning label. After that, I think the MDA, the authority in Singapore, they regulated that the comic book have to be string web and all those. And I got a lot of emails from angry fanboys and people who read manga and anime slamming me, and I felt really bad because I like to read manga and anime and things like that as well, and comic books, and then they start having to string wrap them with parental warning. My fault. So yeah, that's how it all started. And after that, I created many other stories that went viral. So this are some of the top posts that I have over the years. I thought maybe this one that I like to show, which is this one. I'll open it. Manually cut and paste. So this story, I don't know how many of you have seen this video, but just the auntie is giving a very good commentary. But anyway, I didn't shoot this video. So what happened was that my wife happened to see this video on one of her friends' Facebook feed. And then that it has something like 3 comment and 1 like or something like that. And when I saw the video, I just felt that something more need to be done. If you look at this video now, can you visualize the story and how to make it go viral and things like that? So that's what I did. So the thought process that went was that, so what happened there? The baby actually fell out from the window ledge. I think it's on the 3rd floor, and the head got stuck between 2 poles. So she could have died, right? She could have dropped on the floor and died. But there were a few people who tried to climb up. They couldn't, Singaporeans, and they were not strong enough. But there was 2 foreign workers from India. They managed to jump up like Spider-Man, and they saved the baby. And I just felt that at that point of time, there's a good chance that this clip can probably go viral. The story can go viral for the fact that in the same week, there was a story about a Singaporean boy in polytechnic, I think about 18 or 19 years old. He's going around Singapore to beat up foreign workers for the fun of it, to practice his martial art. You know, he thinks he's Bruce Lee and he have to practice it on foreign workers. And the sentiment was there. People were very angry that, you know, you're doing this kind of thing to people who are contributing to our economy and, you know, building our buildings and things like that. So initially, my wife was just sharing with me that maybe the angle we should go for this story is that maybe we can write something about why in this situation, in the area that the baby was living, it's actually a low-cost housing area, 1 and 2 room flats. So when you know that it's going to be a low-income area, you should build grills, right? Because you know that if they are low-income, they're not likely to put in rails because they don't want to spend extra money. Why didn't the government do that? But I felt that if we went with that angle, it'll probably get people angry about the government, going to complain, you know, write bad things and all those. It's going to go nowhere. Just a lot of anger, and yes, it will get a lot of views, but it's not going to serve any greater good. Another angle that I thought was that if you give people a call to action, which is to find who these 2 foreign workers are and to actually reward, sort of like recognize their effort as their heroic effort and so on, maybe that would be a better angle. So that's the angle we went with. So then I quickly took a screen grab of this guy, and after that I shared on social media and so on, asked people to try and find who this person is. So so that we can give him the due recognition, and it happened. So when I posted this post, it was at night, I think something like 11 or 12 midnight, around there. And then I started messaging all the people I know that helped me to get this content to go viral and so on. Again, I reached out to the media, the mainstream media and so on. And by the next day in the morning, I had a lot of calls coming in. Everybody wanted to know what's going on. And they did find these two workers. And the guys from the civil defense, they actually invited me as well and to the press conference that they held on the day to give like a commemorative plaque to the two foreign workers. So we got exclusive, and my wife was the one who went to cover it. And she has a sharp news sense, so she also managed to, when the event was still going on, she also managed to follow the workers to arrange interview with to meet the family, the baby girl and the family, and get some pictures and all those. So I think we were the only media that got that as well. And again, then when the Straits Time and other publication want to use the pictures, they have to reach out to me, and I get the credit again for the whole thing. So that's how I planned the whole thing. And the coverage was very massive, all the way to, you know, like Huffington Post, Times of India and everything. Another thing that I think we did correctly was that the videos, they were not owned by me, but I uploaded in YouTube. Then after that, I got the owner of the video clip to sell the video to Storyful, which is owned by Yahoo. So after the rights is sold to Storyful, nobody else can use the video clip. So I'm the only person who has it on YouTube. So everybody who wants to post the video, they can only use my video. So after that, I got, last year in 2015, so YouTube released a list of the top 10 videos for 2015 in Singapore. This is the number one. It's about 5 million views in total. So yeah, viral stories can be created. It's not, people think that a lot of time it just happened, but it doesn't. A lot of it, it can be planned, it can be staged. So that's just one example. So there are a few others. Another one that give me a lot of page views, but not something I'm proud of, is Edison Chen. Who knows Edison Chen? So Edison Chen is a famous celebrity in Hong Kong. He had a sex scandal where a lot of pictures, nude pictures of other females. Don't go searching for Edison Chen now. Maybe you want to do it when you get home, but he leaked a lot of celebrity nude pictures, famous celebrities in Hong Kong and so on. And so at one point, I think he was one of the number one most searched person in Singapore and so on. So I figured that a lot of the news sources about Edison Chen's scandal and so on, they were in Chinese. So I figured that if I translate them into English, I would probably get a lot of hits. So that's what I did, and I wrote it in a way that it's not about all the porn stuff, and I didn't use all the dirty images, but the clean and legit one, who are the victims and so on. So this post until now is still one of the highest. And in fact, I was on a roll. I was writing a lot about Edison Chen, following up and translating all the English stories. And at one point, I was ranking very high for Edison Chen, to the point that I received a lawyer letter from Edison Chen himself telling me to cease and desist. Well, you know, he said he owned the copyright for some of the leaked media pictures and so on. So okay, I take down the pictures, but the posts are still there. Yeah, so this is Edison Chen. And then, how many of you have heard of Amos Yee? Amos Yee, any fan? So I don't know if you guys know it, but anyway, for Amos Yee, he's this guy who, this boy who went to shoot a video insulting our late founding prime minister when he passed away. So actually, I was I was the first person who blogged about him, and that was when he was 14 years old. Before this whole incident about Lee Kuan Yew happened, he did a video about Chinese New Year where he made fun of Chinese New Year, saying that it's a copy of the English New Year, because there's New Year, right? And the Chinese copy New Year because we call it Chinese New Year, and it's really, really lame. In any case, I wrote about that way earlier, so that went a little viral. But I think when the whole story about Amos Yee came out about regarding Lee Kuan Yew and so on, so this story get picked up again, and people are reading it all over again, and they just link back to the first source, which is this one. Some other stuff, there was also one about NS is something that I really hate in Singapore, National Service. So for those people who are not from Singapore, we have to serve 2.5 years. For me, it was 2.5, now it's 2 years in National Service. So it depends on your luck. Some of us get good vocation. I got a crappy one to just sit at the sea and guard the sea, but I'm just looking at the sea for my whole 2 years and wasting my time. So I'm always very opinionated about National Service. I think it could be done in a more constructive way and a better way, even the reservist systems and things like that. So I wrote a post about a guy who gave up his citizenship and he went to take up citizenship in the UK because he really, really hated the NS system. And he became very successful there. So this post went really viral as well, to the point that I think there was some response from the Ministry of Defence and things like that. Some more recent example. For Singaporeans, if you watch the National Day Parade, there was a girl who was doing the sign language thing. I don't know how to do sign language, but she looked really beautiful when she do it. So it's this girl called Neo Yu Kim. So I figured that if I write something about her, there's that feel good element and so on, and that got shared very widely as well. And Joseph Schooling, the first Singaporean to win a gold medal in swimming and beating his childhood idol Michael Phelps along the way. So I wrote something about what we can learn from him, yeah, and how brands should not be hijacking his success, how he should not hijack his success and so on. So that got a lot of views. And any North Korean here? Probably not, right? So I won't get a nuke. But anything about North Korea generally get very good page view. So I wrote something about Kim Jong-un, and when they said that he cut his own hair. So I did some Photoshop images of him with different kind of haircut and all those. And until now, it has very good view. So whenever I want traffic, just write any shit about North Korea, people will believe it. You can say the most ridiculous thing, people will think it's true because nothing comes out, nothing goes in. So yeah. And then things really got serious for me, I would say probably around 2013. That's where I start commercializing my whole blog and so on. So that's because it comes with the proliferation of social media like Facebook, Twitter, Instagram and so on. Before that, it wasn't, if you think about it, the smartphone wasn't invented not that long ago. The same for the light of Facebook, Twitter, Instagram and so on. So that's where I start thinking, you know, maybe I can scale it up from a one-man blog to having to becoming like a content site where I can have editorial staff manning it. And then that's where I migrated it from WordPress.com to WordPress.org to have full control of the ads management and other functionalities. So that's, yeah. Why WordPress? There's a few reasons. At least for me, it's easy to use and idiot-proof. I'm not really a very tech person. I can't code. So there are a lot of plugins that's available, and there's a lot of beautiful themes thanks to the developer. There's some of them are free, some of them just cost a little bit of money, but not that expensive anyway. And the progression to scale up from WordPress to .org is, for non-tech savvy users like me, is not that hard. So you can actually start from the .com, and then you slowly, maybe you buy the domain, and then you start to see that maybe you can scale it up. You can do the change from there. And generally, you get very good SEO, and I find that there's the multi-author role and other assignments that work very well for me. So I've used other CMS before in SPH, and when I was working on launching Youth Olympic Games and a few other previous jobs, and some of the problems that I face sometimes is that for some of the proprietary-owned one, because the development, everything is done in-house, sometimes the updates and so on are very slow, and for those people who work with your in-house tech team, you will know the pain. You'll know the pain of, like, you know, going through your IT department to get some updates and things to your CMS. So monetization through WordPress, there are a few ways that I monetize my sites. So one of it is to serve text ads, banner ads and so on, and videos and so on through the site. So this is a very small portion of income, things like Google, Initi, Unruly Media and so on, when they put the videos. Affiliate marketing, this works for some people, doesn't work so well for me. Like, there's Amazon, Airbnb, Grab, Hotel Quickie. So basically you put in codes, and if people use your promo code, you get a cut. So I know someone who's getting something like 5,000 USD a month just because people buy books from Amazon clicking on his link. I think you only get $1 per click. So there's like 5,000 people buying. It's a lot of sales for Amazon. And then there's content marketing, which is where people pay you. This is where the bulk of the income comes from, where people pay me to write posts about their brands and so on. Like, for instance, the most recent one I did is probably for Coca-Cola. So I write stuff about how Coca-Cola goes well with all kind of food and things like that. And related services. This is something that I find that some people don't realize, that when you have a blog or a site, beyond that, there's actually it's actually a platform for you to sell other related services, which is why I have that social media agency part of it, because it helps me build a brand presence and it gives me some credibility when I pitch to clients and so on. So that contributes to part of my income as well, and it actually helped my career. So when I apply for jobs and so on, generally people find me more credible because I walk the talk, I know how to make viral content, I have evidence that I can do it, and it speaks much louder than, you know, I just say I can do it, but I have things to show. So that sweet spot. The income breakdown at the moment for me is something like that. I won't go into the numbers, but it's something like that. The day job and agency and blog. And if any of you are looking into balancing that, it depends on what worked for you and how what kind of parallel business or related activities that you can run to supplement the income from your day job. Yeah. Is there enough time for me to go through the? What? Okay. So I just thought I'll share a bit about how I built my site from a one-person blog to what it is now in just three simple steps. I think the first step is, of course, scaling up, which is expanding your team. So the more content you have, the higher traffic, the more ad revenue. How do you get more content? So you need more writers. So if you think budget is an issue, you can always hire interns first, get contributors. There are people who will write for free in a way, but in exchange for certain things like maybe free trips and things like that. So you hire editors and writers when you have the budget eventually. Then you distribute your content to publishers, like the arrangement that I have with Yahoo, Singtel, and so on. And then after that, you growth hack your content using things like SEO, social media marketing, and so on. So if any of you is interested in any of this, just speak to me after this. It's 5 minutes, okay? Yeah. And of course, you need to beef up on sales. This is something that a lot of people are not comfortable with. They don't like to do it. But I think that if you don't like to do it, maybe you want to appoint somebody else to do it for you. You can get agencies to represent you, or you can hire some salespeople. And I think volumes matter. The more pitches you do, probably out of every 10 pitch, you can convert about one. That will give you some income. And also you work out a sales funnel to weed out the time waster. Time waster being that I get a lot of queries every day, a few hundred emails a day. But how do you know which of these are genuine, which of these will convert into sales lead? Maybe you want to have a process where you can weed them out. So the first step is always the email reply, and after that maybe a phone call before you go and meet them, because meeting takes time, you have to travel and this and that. And after that, if it doesn't turn to anything, it's just a waste of time. So you have to work out some funnel and maybe get somebody to represent you for that. Networking, get out there to meet people, like event like this, it works. So if any of you are looking to run advertorials or content marketing, look for me. And to catch a big fish, like for instance Coca-Cola, you may have to do some free work at first. So some of the work I did for Coke at the initial phase, they were free. But then after that, you built out the rapport and so on, they will look for you in the long run. And and build out a solid industry reputation, because other people saying good things about you, it's a million times better than you saying good things about yourself. So that's what I believe in, and that's my work ethics as well. And the last one is about thinking business. So this is about setting your CPM to benchmark your rate. You find out the rate cards for the top publishers in the market, for instance, like Wall Street Journal and so on, how much are they charging for per 1,000 impressions? And then after that, you count your impression and you benchmark that to quote maybe a little bit lower. So that is, in that way, you're at the market rate. And then you put yourself in the shoes of the marketers. They are looking at things like the return on investment, the ROI, the numbers, and so on. So if you put yourself in their shoe, it makes it easier for you to pitch to them. And you go for repeat clients versus one time off. So whenever I have a sales lead, I will try to get them to run like a whole series of advertorials and things like that, rather than a one time off, because that gives me more income in the long run. And growth hacking sales, I always leave room for negotiation. I never say no. So if you give me some assignment that I think is ridiculous, I will quote you a ridiculous price, and if you're still willing to pay for it, I will do it. So like I mentioned about the artificial vagina, that one is no. But maybe some other things, like, I don't know, make me wear pink, and there was some stuff from Rovio, Angry Bird, they want me to wear pink and take outfit of the day. So if it's something like this I'm not comfortable with, I'll just quote a ridiculous price, and they're still okay. By all means, I think there's a price tag to everything. Yeah. And work ethics, always be contactable, responsive, professional, and humility goes a long way. I believe a lot in that. I try not to work with Diva if I can, and I also don't accept jobs from brands which you don't believe in. Yeah. That's it. I'm done. I have some case studies as well, so just to share, other than those viral content that I did some viral stuff for brands that actually went well. So one of the best ones is this with Changi Recommend. 2 minutes, okay. Changi Recommend is a travel Wi-Fi router. So this post, we were the first site to complete the advertorial. So we have a first mover advantage. The blog post alone has about 160,000. I think it's about 200,000 read as of now and more, and still growing. And the organic reach for the Facebook was over 50,000 just on my Facebook alone. And it generates so much sales for the product that the client actually told me that they couldn't meet the demand, and they had to order more routers in order to meet the demand for this. I'm still working with them on a long-term basis. So this is one of the best campaigns so far. Yeah. Coca-Cola, Silk Air. Yeah, that's it. I'm done. So this is...
If any of you have any questions for him, maybe we have some time for your questions. Anyone has questions? Any questions for us?
Sorry, I thought it's over. Okay.
You mentioned Pitch did a market, right? The market rate.
Sorry?
The market rate.
In one of your latest slides, you said to pitch near the market rate.
The one on the what?
The market rate.
Where do you get the market rate?
Oh, the market rate?
Yeah. How do you find out what the market rate
is? I'll just pretend to be an advertiser and email Wall Street Journal or Straits Time, and they will send it to you and say, I want to advertise, and they will send it to you. But some of it, they put it on their websites as well. And for me, it's because I used to work in the news publisher, so I have access to those. But I think generally, there are public information. You can get it either on their websites, or you can just email them and say, I want to run an advertisement, how much is it? And they will get back. Yeah.
All right, thanks.
Yeah.
So, anybody else with any questions? All right? Okay. So, thanks, Alvin.
Thank you.
Thank you again. We will have a few sessions, as mentioned. The developer